So welcome everybody. The idea of this session was basically to give an introduction to modeling with SPML using some tools I developed. And I will start with a short presentation, give a bit of introduction, and then we're basically jumping right into the remainder. Please ask questions along the way. I have to admit, this is there is definitely things for beginners here, but without any programming experience and so on, some things will be difficult to follow. But I can tell you, no matter what your background, you will take something away from the workflows at least we use for modeling with SPML models. Okay, so without further ado, I will give a short presentation, and then we basically jump into the coding part. I'm not sure how familiar you are with SPML, but basically, if you want to model with SPML, you should at least have a basic understanding of what SPML is. I would say it's a de facto standard if you have process-based ordinary differential equation models. So if you have let's say a one compartment or a few compartment model, which is well steered, you have ODEs to describe the things, and you somehow with processes, then I would definitely use SPML for modeling that. There are many other fields where you could use SPML, but I would say if your model or your planned project falls in this project, use SPML. So if you don't know what is SPML, especially so if you made a jack here at point number one, then you should look into SPML and definitely have a look at the SPML specification. You get all the information on the SPML webpage, a bit newer page, but basically the specifications are under documents. And then you can click on specification, and this SPML level 3 version 2 specification is the last one. If you look at that, and then you get a level of basically the specification, what objects and what kind of information you can store in SPML. And I think this is also the main challenge in modeling in general, but in modeling with SPML, that you have to abstract your real problem into programming language or here into a standard. Like I said, if you're process-based, then this is pretty straightforward, because SPML has something like reactions, which is this processes, and it has species, which is basically the entities which are changed by the processes. Yeah, the big advantage if you put your model in SPML is that it's reproducible and exchangeable. We'll demonstrate this also shortly in the tutorial. Mainly means you can run it later, and you can also use a large set of different tools. And for instance, you could use your SPML utils to build your model, then use something like Copazi or Roadrunner to do your analysis and simulation of the models. Later on use other tools for parameter fitting like Amici or visualization like SciSPML and so on. So it's having this one format, SPML, allows you to use all the different things with basically one file. In addition to this core information about reactions, processes, and the entities, SPML allows to annotate your model, so basically describe what is in your model, and also describe why you put certain things in your model. It's basically done via either via nodes or annotations to biomedical or modeling ontologies. There are packages for SPML which allow additional models or model frameworks also to be described, like SPML FPC package. I would say it's the most popular besides the core package, and it's basically used for constraint-based modeling. There are also other packages which are very useful, the SPML comp for hierarchical model composition, or things like SPML distrib if you want to store uncertainties or distributions. Yeah, that's a high level overview. If you have questions on the way, just ask. I think this is much easier. No matter how the question is, I think it's much better like if you ask right away, and then we can just clarify things. Also comment if you know, if you all know that. Frank, I know you know that, but if the rest knows all this stuff by heart, then let's just let me know, and then we speed a bit up. Today we present three tools. SPML Utils is basically a Python package which you can install, and I would say the main focus or strength of it is like model creation, SPML model creation and manipulation in SPML. It has support for annotations, unit support, and so on. And it provides like some simple way to describe why you did certain things in the models and document the models with biomedical annotations. And this is basically the package we will use to create models in the following. I developed a report for SPML, which allows you to have a look what is in the SPML. This is so-called SPML for humans, and it's part of SPML Utils. And we will use that to inspect the SPML models we created. This is available from spmlforhumans.de, and you can basically then upload the SPML and visualize it. Perhaps one comment about SPML, like a common problem if things are not working is that your SPML file is just not valid. You should always use like validation on your SPML file, and on the SPML homepage, there's a validator available where you can just upload your files or paste SPML or URL to a file, and then you can just validate it, and you will get basically feedback if things are not working. So the first thing is if an SPML model is not working, I would run validation on it and check what's wrong. If it's correct, then most of the time either information is missing from the SPML, or the tool is not supporting certain features, or the tool has a bug. I would say the first line of defense is here validation. In addition, there's a tool called SciSPML, which is for visualization of networks, that you can load the SPML and get different graphs which allow you to inspect your model. This I find very helpful during the creation process of SPML for visualization, and also finding like problems in the model. Last but not least, there's SPML Sim, which allows simulation of SPML. I'm not showing too much about SPML Sim today, but probably in the end we see how far we get along with that. Okay. So if there are questions until now, please speak up. Otherwise I will just start going. So I thought a bit about how to do this tutorial, and I thought that the best way to do it is basically just to not prepare anything and just show how I normally would do that, and basically like run you through like, okay, what would I do when I build a new model. And I think this is very instructive because many of the steps are what you should do, and I think it documents also very well like how you would work with SPML. So basically the first thing you have to do is like you have to have an understanding of what you want to model. And this is basically what you did in the first weeks of your PhD or whatever. You read papers about the system, you understood what's going on, and you have like some mental picture of what should be in the model. And now you're at the point, okay, now I really want to create the model. And I decided like, okay, it's a process-based ODE model, I will use SPML, and so let's get started. So first thing, what I always would do with every project is basically create a repository for the model. Meaning that you have like version control of your files and so on, and that you basically do that you have tracking of files and versioning of model files and so on, and especially if something goes wrong, that you have a backup in a server somewhere else, and that you can invite collaborators and work with other people on the project. So the first thing is pretty easy. I use here GitHub, just making a new project. Normally you can put a description, I will add a README, and then you create a repository. Then it's basically you have a online thing. If you want to do it private, you have to set it private, but for this example I use a public thing, so basically everybody can now access what's going on here, and also provide bug fixes and so on. So what we do now is, yeah, we have to work locally with these files. So normally you just check out the repository. So and how to do that? It's basically you have to have a bit of information on about Git, but basically it's that you clone the repository and get here the repository ID, and then you would just clone it locally so that you have the files files locally. And that's now I have basically this information about this tutorial here locally. I have my README in here, and I can start working on that. So next thing you need is like some code editor, I would say, to build the model. And so in this case, I use PyCharm. I will then just open a new project, open. And then we go to the combine, basically this project we just have, we've created. This is our combined tutorial, and use this as a new project. So that's basically the first step you have to do. So you have a project, and now we want to build a model. And for building the model, we will use SPML utils and also SPML sim. So somehow we need an environment where we install that. So the way to do that is, I would say, like creating a virtual environment where you install your information, install your libraries, and you need something like a requirements file where you write all your requirements for the project. In this case, we need definitely the SPML utils. I also list pandas, matplotlib for now. I think this should be good. And then we have these requirements and would create a new virtual environment. And this one, I call it just combine 2021. It's created a virtual environment in Python 3.8, and then I install the requirements here. Okay, sorry, I have to. So, and SPML utils is one of these packages, is on pip, and by providing this the requirements file, you can easily install that, and then we have an environment where we can import basically everything. While this is installing, we would basically create a directory where we build our model. So I call this here just my model. And here we can then create our model file. What we still have to set up here is the Python interpreter. So we have to tell the GUI or your tool what virtual environment you want to use. So in this case, add virtual environment, you would just select the environment we just created. I think we called it was combine. Oh, where is it? Combine 2021. So bin, I think bin Python is the right thing. Yeah. Okay, and then we have that. Yeah. You can use different editor, like Visual Studio Code, I would say, is the second, or it's the other very popular option, but it basically has a very similar features to that. Okay, so far so good. We have to wait a bit for the indexing here, but in the meanwhile, we can already start with a new model. So. So my model, so I will just call this model one. So, and now we have to import basically a bit of helpers from SPML utils to create our models. So we need from SPML utils the factory. This is basically the everything. This is basically which allows you to create the different SPML models. And then we would also use from SPML utils metadata. We would import everything. This allows us to do annotations and things like that. The next step is that we basically create a models object. So this is pretty simple. We just create the model. There's also some opportunity, some possibility to create this directly from JSON or YAML and so on. But in this case, we would just define the model object directly here. So we would have an Opel model, and then we can set many things on the actual model. So we can define all the different SPML objects, and and so on. So what we would do here, we just name this something like my model, and then we have to give certain fields. So basically, this should already be a minimal model. Doesn't contain any information, but we should basically be able to create that. And so let's just test what is happening if we're creating that. So we would just call the create model functions. We provide the models as argument. We would, in addition, define a results path where we want to write the model. I'm not sure it's output here. So we would just write these relative to where we are here, and in a results folder. So we would just write them basically right next to here, so like a new directory results, where we would write our model results and just need the import for the import this name, parsley. And that's basically it. You would do the imports, create a model object, and then call the create model function on that. And then execute the thing. And then we see already like we're getting some errors. And errors are basically, okay, certain things are required. I have to say, like, this is not one-to-one to the SPML specification, but here's more like you get certain warnings or like errors if for things which I think should really be on a model and increase the interoperability. Like, for instance, I think like a model without an ID is like, oh man, it creates more. It doesn't harm you to put an ID on there, and like in so many contexts, an ID is very helpful. And this is basically just, it takes 5 seconds to write an ID. So I, in my opinion, you should always write an ID on a model. Yeah, so we can set that. So the first argument is basically an ID. So we call this here our combine our model one. So we have this one required argument, and then should be able to create it, and we can then get some feedback. Sorry, I still have to make some settings. So basically, if you want colorful and nice output, you should emulate the terminal in an output console and just activate this flag here. In Visual Studio Code, this works automatically, but here, if you want a more colorful output, then you we'll do that, and getting also some debug messages. Okay, where are these messages coming from, and so on. If you case you want to see what is going on. So yeah, in this case, what happened? We basically got some info. This model is created. We got a warning that the name should be set. Basically, warnings I would say is like something like best practices in this case, and otherwise you get a file, and we can look at the file. And basically, there's not much in there. We just created the SPML with this model object, and there's not much in there for now. Okay, so we want always to fix warnings. This is a good idea. This is just an example model from Combine 2021. Okay, so far so good. And this would basically just fix the model, and we can execute this. Okay. What we want in addition is often that you want to write a bit of description why you build these models and so on. And for this, we can use the nodes. And the nodes are basically just markdown, which you can write on the model. And so you, here you can then describe something. This is two headings like model. Yeah, was build. Okay, build. So, and if you want, you could provide some some other highlighting. So basically, what is the, possible in Markdown, you can just write a TS node. And this nodes, this work on all SPML objects. And this is basically what I would use to document what you are doing. So if you create objects like reaction species and so on, you can easily create nodes that you then write on the model and can access them. Like for instance, we're seeing here. Now, okay, we're having nice nodes in here, which are available as here as HTML from the nodes. Yeah. At this point, I would basically I would start to do a visualization in SPML for utils, SPML for humans. So. To just see that everything which I expect is in the model, so we can just open this from our local file. Git. We did this in the combine 21 tutorial. We have the results here, are our models, and can just open that. In this case, we see there's almost nothing in there. There's one model, but we can see our nodes here, and yeah. Not much other overview of that, but this is basically like that. What I often do is that I just serve my files locally and then use the URLs of the files to just display my my models via submit URL. This works quite nicely. Perhaps I can quickly show that. So it would basically be. You can easily serve this models now. This is all installed. So we would use this terminal here, and we would just go to our results folder and serve the files. And then we basically have a file server where our models are served and have local URLs for our files, and then we can use this port to serve the files online. I think I have to just provide the port as far as I remember. No, I have to start something. I think I have to provide start. No, HTTP. Okay. So yeah, I just want to provide these files online. So I basically have now a server where I can access online my files. And then I have this URLs, and I can just use this URLs to use the reports online. Exactly. We see the same model was created online. But of course, the nice thing is I can do things like just putting this here into the, like basically while I develop this here, I could just put this into a string. This makes it very easy to create a report for me. So this time I'm just showing some hacks which I use here, but perhaps there's a better way to do that. But so I would just use that. I have the complete URL of this model now, and I can that just print the report basically very easily for now. So okay. Okay, but otherwise you can just upload the file and this should also work. This is basically just showing some certain workflows, and then you can just click on here and get automatically the report. It's just nice to have this a bit of more integrated, then it's very easy to just immediately see the updated report based on your local files, which you serve. Okay, so that's it. We basically have a first model. Now we want to add additional objects to the model. Basically we have to think about what we want to model. So in this case, we would just start with a simple metabolic conversion of two species. And to get this additional objects in, we have to put this in the model object. So here's our model. There's not much in there, but we would now put species in there. And can this create this via the species objects? And here we also we have a lot of fields. It's basically I would say it helps a lot if you know the SPML specification, then it's basically straightforward. If you know what you want to write, then it's you just type the first two or three letters, and then you know exactly what is coming out there. If you're a bit, if you don't know SPML too well, it definitely helps to get a bit of information about the specification. And then most of these, I would say, is self-explanatory. So yeah, so we would create here a species as one. One thing in SPML is a species has to be always located in a compartment. So we want to have a dynamic species or a dynamic biological entity here. There are different ways to do dynamical things. You could make a parameter which is dynamic, but the parameters are basically not in this reaction species or process entity graph. So if you have something which you want to have in the graph and later on in visualizations, you should put it into species and reactions. Otherwise, if you just want dynamics on something which is not in a stoichiometric matrix or so, you can also put it in parameters and just write, for instance, rate rules on parameters. Okay, so here we would just add a species, but for a species we need compartments. So we would add a compartment and give it an SID SID for now. And not much more. And then we will just see which error is coming out of here. Here we need a compartment. This is our compartment C. And normally we should give something like an either initial amount or initial concentration. So we would just set the initial concentration to something, to 10. For the compartment, we will also define a concentration, a size in this case, and the size would just be one on our size units. Until now, we don't have any units, so we don't really know what this means, but this means just, this is one unit of compartment units, and this is one, basically, initial concentration here. And this would, we now also have to define, what if this species is either in concentration or in amounts. Okay, so lots of things to think about at the beginning, but it's more you have to think about, you have to understand SPML is basically an abstraction of you have certain entities in certain compartments, and the processes which transport or convert this objects. And so you can always think about either the amounts you have in a certain compartment, also the concentrations, but also other things like particle numbers and so on. But I would say amount and concentrations are the main things. And so for a species, you have to basically define, what is my initial concentration or my initial amount? And do I want to track that in amount or in concentration? And this is basically done via the has only substance units. And if you set this to false, then it's basically concentration. If you set this to true, then it's basically amounts. So so far so good. This is, we will just try to create that and see what the errors are that we get. in this case, okay, we get a lot of warnings and errors. And okay, and so we have to somehow step through that. And this is also like what I said, like it's a bit annoying, but it's also the strength of this this tool, because it like gives you the hints and the information what you should put in and what how you can make your model better. So for instance, what we see here, like this is basically orange, and it basically says like green is good, everything is okay, red is really bad, and orange is like okay, like this model is a valid model, it doesn't really have errors, but it has a lot of warnings. And if we just look through the warnings, we basically see that there's basically a lot of unit consistency things in here, and yeah, component consistency and so on. And so on. Yeah, unit things make sense because we didn't define any units so far on this actual model. So yeah, to get rid of these for now is just deactivate the units consistency during the creation. And then we would get less warnings. Okay, this looks much better. And we saw basically all our warnings were unit warnings. So for now, like we're just deactivating them, our model is still valid. We just don't have any units in there. And by this flag, we say, okay, we also don't want to check for the units. Okay, in addition, we have like certain things here, name, SPO terms, and so on, which we should set on the species or compartments. So we can quickly do that. SPO terms are pretty easy. There's basically a class which allows auto completion. So you would just do SPO dot. And then in this case, this is look what you have here. I think there is a physical compartment in here. So we would annotate this with physical compartment. And most of the time, depends on what the species is. They are most of the time either macromolecules or simple chemicals. So in this case, we just annotate the simple chemicals. And while we edit, we also give the names. So let's call this just cytosol. And let's call this here also something like okay, glucose. So to make a minimal example, I need a name for that. So, and I will just call this glucose. Okay. So good. So this seems to work. We got rid of all the warnings. And so I think this is a good step also basically to create a first commit. It's always like we have the nice thing, we have this all in our version control, but until now we didn't version control anything. So we have to add these files now. And check that we don't commit any secrets or unnecessary files like this idea. This is basically the files of the IDE. So we don't want these in here. Oh, where did this open? It opened here. So we want to ignore the IDEA files. In this case, status. And basically add everything else. Git add and the requirements. And then, yeah, at this point, yeah, we did the first commit and we have now basically the model and the files and also the scripts up here. Yeah, often I don't even track the models, but I track basically the scripts. Like the problem is like with diffs in Git and version control is that with XML, it doesn't work very well. But of course, on my model one file, it's very easy to track changes in the actual model creation. So this allows very nice version control of modeling also by just version controlling the model creation file instead of the actual model. Okay. Yeah, so we have our SPO terms, we have our names. So what I would do often is, we can add some additional description and we can add like some annotations to that. Yeah, what I often use in projects and I really like is basically a bit of automatic code formatting. This just helps like to, you don't have to take care so much about this, that this that looks nice or not. So often like I would just add, I would add stuff like black to a project or add rich also for the output to the project. And then, and then we can easily reformat also our code. So I just go into my model and just reformat our model file very easily, which is, you know, is now nicely formatted, much easier to read and so on. Okay, yeah, so this was automatic formatting. And yet now we would put annotations and notes on that. Yeah. Annotations are basically just tuples where we have the BQB or BQM identifiers. Most of the time, this is just BQB is, and our compartment is in this case cytosol. Now comes the one thing which is not working well in the combined community, I would say, and this is like looking up ontologies. But I'm because we are. Here, so like what I normally use is like the ontology lookup service, and there you it's pretty easy to search for ontologies. You would basically look for cytosol and so on, and then you can just take these terms and put them into your model. So NKit is a very good ontology, I would say. It's a very broad, so like lots of things are from its biological domain and biomedicine are found in there. Go is also something which is very good, not so much for compartments, but for the compartments, you should also use things like FMR. And there's another one, but it's, yeah, basically it's, we have our Go term in here. We have to fix the typo in a second. And just for demonstration, we would also put the FMR in here. Okay, and then, yeah, this is stuff which should work more automatically. But for now, I say like this is how I annotate models. Just looking this up for certain things which I reuse a lot. I have a own dictionaries where I should just annotate it. Things once and reuse them, but like yeah, for a new model, you basically have to put the things in here. And for the species, we would just annotate somehow the glucose. Normally for species, it makes sense to put KB identifiers in there and the INHI keys. Glucose is unfortunately very it's not very well defined, but yeah, we would just use here, for instance, the KB term and the NKit term. We can add to that. Okay. KB and NKit. I would say it's not too much work. The annotation. I would say the lookup of the annotation is really annoying and the copy paste all the time. Otherwise, annotation is working pretty okay. Okay, so we have that, and then we try to create the model again. Probably we will get errors, and here basically we get errors that our terms which we used do not match. Like this is basically doing some automatic checking against identifiers that these are valid annotations somehow here. This is not really a valid term because the patterns are a bit strange for NKit. So we have to do something like this here. This is basically because all the ontologies are also not really consistent or how they are checked in identifiers.org. But yeah. But then basically, yeah, if we fix that and wrote this a bit different, then it should work. And also, if we look now at our model, yeah, we have the species and the compartment in, and we get very nicely now the SBO terms, physical compartment, cytosol, all this meta information resolved. We have, like, I would say, like, took a few minutes now to document the model. if you just include this in the beginning in the workflow, it's very nice. And basically you have this nice report where you already have this information. Another tool is like Coparse, you just read that and you basically you created an exchangeable documentation of what this is. So far so good. What do we have? Okay. From the biology, this is all not very interesting so far. I would I would just demonstrate the units as last point, and then I would go to put a reaction, and then we try to simulate simulate the model. So okay. Oh, yeah, this was okay. I'm sorry. Normally, the big advantage is also like normally I should do always I normally always do this black formatting and have it integrated, because this also makes the diffs much nicer, because all the form like the files are basically formatted every time the same thing, no matter how you write or what you put in between, and then the diffs on the model files become much nicer. Okay, sorry, this was not very good. Normally I can amend this somehow, but I have no clue how to do this right now. Okay. Okay, that's basically it. So but we still saw like before, we have a lot of problems with the units. So if we reactivate the units validation here on the file, we still see there's, basically, we have a lot of warnings on the units. Things like compartment cannot be fully checked. Of course, it makes sense because we didn't define a unit on the object. So we should define units. How we do define units here is basically just creating a units class, which is defining the unit strings. So in this case, we would call it just u, and this is just this is inheriting from units, and then we define the units we are interested in. So there are already a few units in there, but we want some additional units. Like for instance here, often you track your species in millimolar. So we want to add the corresponding units to the model. So what we want basically is something like a millimole in our model. And so this is unit definition, and this unit definition is basically just taking an ID and a definition string. But because here the basically this ID is identical to the definition, we can just leave it like that, and then we have millimole defined. But we also need an we'll just write this with an E. What we also need, like later on for the reactions, is something per time unit. So it's just to demonstrate a bit of a more complicated unit definition. So in this case, we would call this unit definition millimole per minute, and our definition would be basically how we would write the unit normally. So it's just millimole per minute, and then the SPMLU just figures out how to create the correct units. The nice thing by doing this via a class is that we can get code completion on our unit objects. So we would basically define the units for our compartments now. So just setting the unit, and the unit for our compartment is in this kind, it's liter. And so some of the base units are already defined, so we don't have to redefine them every time. And here for the species, we basically have to say, okay, what are the substance units? Our substance is all like I said before, you have to know a bit of SPML to use like SPML utils. Substance units means basically, what are the units of the actual substance? But because we set the units as concentration, our actual values are now substance units per volume unit. And because this is in a compartment here with a volume of liter, our actual units for the species are now millimole per liter or millimolar. What you also should set in addition to the units on the objects is the model units. And these are just defining basically globally what are your time units, which I would say is one of the most important things. So we would track time here in minute. Of course, we need a minute defined. Let's see if we have this. No, we don't. We can see we don't have a the unit minute, and we see also this stuff like this done in the code completion unresolved attribute, meaning okay, this unit wasn't defined yet. So we will just define this. And then we have our minute, we have time unit. What else do we need? We need a substance unit. This is our millimolar. We're checking everything in millimole. Our extent unit is also in millimole. We have a volume unit. This is our liter. We used it also for the compartments. And we have, normally we have, a, I think, length unit. Length unit is you put meter. And I think with most of this should be good. So we define all the units on the model and we define the units on the objects. And then we basically should be see if we if this is getting better. So in some way this got worse, and it basically got worse because we didn't say that we want to use this as the units as actual units on our model. We just have to say the units should be defined here in this class, and then we see we have now a full model. The area we should still set, but for now it's okay. And we then see also in the front end we now have the complete the unit information here rendered, and see nicely okay what are the units of our different objects and so on. This is liter and so on. This chance I want to use to also demonstrate. I will add another species and the reaction, and then I will demonstrate. I will basically demonstrate PsySBML, how you would integrate this in this workflow. So PsySBML is basically a plugin for Cytoscape. So we would start Cytoscape in the backend. So normally this runs just on another monitor, and on one window you would do the actual programming, and on another window you would have the report, and on the third one you have the graph visualization, and then you always have like this complementary information somehow to see what is going on in the model. And I find this very helpful because you get different views, and you have one file, the SBML, and you use different tools, like for instance you have also Copasi open and so on, load in Copasi, and so you get the different aspects, which make it then easier to work with that. So basically, this is Cytoscape. It's a bit small right now, but okay. It's now about demonstrating a bit the integration workflows. So we want to integrate our created model here with the Cytoscape, and we can do this easily via the SBML which we created. So basically we get here a result from the model factory, and this we can then use to visualize I hope this is called like that, otherwise I have to look up the function. And we would just what do we need? We need an SBML path. And this is basically the path we got from our factory. And then we need, if you want to delete the session, Cytoscape session, every time we run this script. And in this case, we want to, we want to keep it just to show the differences. And then if you would now run the script, it's basically directly integrating with Cytoscape. And so the model was created, and we get the model visualizations here. There are different model visualizations here. I think the base visualization is the most important for our modeling. This is corresponding to the species reaction graph. And right now it's very boring because basically we have like one species in one compartment. There's not much of a graph here. Already the kinetic kinetic graph can be very interesting because it provides one like the basically the connection between all the SPML objects. And so like we can see here, this is correct and our glucose was put into the correct compartment. And we can see this visually without having like basically if you have like 20 compartments and so on, we don't have to check in our SPML file. We just see visually, okay, this glucose is in the right compartment. I'm done. I also have no dangling objects. This is often what happens if you get bigger bigger projects, that you get parameters which are not connected to anything and not modifying. So it's basically showing you problems in this graph. Yeah, but to make it a bit more interesting, so we will just create basically a second species and a reaction. And then glucose 6-phosphate here. This is in the same compartment. We have no concentration. This is glucose 6-phosphate. And of course, we need different annotations. I just delete them here now. And yeah, okay. And of course, nice thing is like normally if I do stuff like that, I would just add a fix me and then later on, like I can also track very nicely via the IDEs what still has to be done in the model. It's more like you can open issues for certain things in the model and track directly in the model file what still has to be done. This I find also very nice. Okay, we have this two species, and then we would add some reactions to the model in this case. Yeah, just a simple conversion reaction. So this is a reaction object. Here we would also give a name, hexokinase, SID, call this just HK. We give a name, hexokinase, an SBO term. In this case, this is a biochemical reaction. Biochemical. Oh god, there's also the problem if you do biochemical reaction. Okay, this is how it's found. And then we need some equations and some formula. So I think do we need an equation? Okay, quickly look what we need on that. Basically need the equation and formula. The equation is basically telling what is reacting to what. In our case, glucose is, yeah, we just want to do it irreversible to glucose 6-phosphate. So we would do this here. If we have modifiers and so on, we can basically write them in brackets here via simple syntax. Yeah, this would be the equation. And then we need also a formula. And our formula is just a string of basically a string and a unit. So we need some definition here. I'll just keep this empty for now. And here we would we need a millimole per minute, and we need a unit. This should be in there. So we can create some simple Michaelis-Menten kinetic or something like that, irreversible here in this case. So for that, we need some parameters. We can define this either as global objects or define them here locally. I would just create a local to local parameters here, Vmax. The Vmax is in this case, if I don't have any other terms in the equation, is just the units of the reaction, and then I need another parameter for the Km. And because our we define our species in millimolar, our Km's for unit correctness also have to be in millimolar. Don't have the unit millimolar yet, so we would just add that to the model. So millimolar is a new unit definition, which is, we call this millimolar, and we define it. How is millimolar defined? It's just millimole per liter. So done with the unit definition. And yeah, then we just have to figure out what we did here. The comma is still missing. Then we have our two parameters, which we can use in our equation. Of course, we could also, like, now, normally it makes sense to annotate them, give them full names. So you should do something like SPO term, SPO maximal, maximal velocity. The Km is normally a Michaelis-Menten constant. So SPO Michaelis-Menten. Michaelis constant for, yeah, okay, it would be substrate, but okay, we're good enough. We should normally give names, annotations, and so on. Or here, yeah, what I often do is I just also store the, basically where I get the values from. You could store this as uncertainties, but often, like, I have things like from, I don't know, ABC 1987, das KM, so I would just document this directly here as a note on where did it get the value, which is very helpful later on. And by being able to have a mechanism to do that, is yeah, this is very very helpful. Okay, so I would have the parameters. Still, we need a weight equation. So here we would do a Vmax times simple glucose over glucose plus our Km. Normally, it's, I would say it's a good practice also to add the name of the substance to the Km. Okay, and that's basically it. Like, like, the point is, like, I don't have to think too much. I will just run it and see what the error is. This is like, yeah. Okay, what we saw already, like, okay, something dated up. Okay, the good thing is, okay, this looks already from the reaction graph. This is what we wanted. It's called hexokinase. Okay, this looks pretty good here. If you look at the, if you look at the connectivity, this looks also pretty good. Our reaction is connected here. The problem is that these parameters don't seem to be connected. So, like, probably we did something wrong there. Okay, so let's see what's going on here in the output. Okay, so what we see basically, it's complaining somehow about only blah, 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 math element. We see this is not connected. This is, shows us somehow this math element was probably not created, because otherwise the reaction would be affected by these parameters. There's no link. This is what I mean by dangling parameters. We see something is not like it should be. And we see also here, this is, something went really wrong. And so we should go, like, scroll up and see what the errors are. And basically we can just go through and go to the first error, like the warnings is okay. We should set the names. Errors like parsing this here did not work, factory. Unexpected end. And as soon as we look here, we see, ah, yeah, there are also too many brackets, too many opening brackets, not enough closing brackets. So let's just fix that quickly. We don't need the closing bracket, the opening bracket here. And then we would just rerun it and see, okay, now everything is good. Also, our connectivity graph looks now like it should. And our model report, it's basically looks pretty good. This looks like the equation we did. Yeah, seeing the kinetic log, getting annotations, and so on. So I would say this is pretty straightforward how you would do things. Of course, a very nice thing about being in a Python environment is that you can do a lot of programmatic stuff, like here, like basically what I did manually here now. Like, you basically can abstract a lot of this and just write scripts for things. And yeah, just out of time, I will just let's do that. Like, this was the idea, like, to just try to create everything right now. So let's not copy any code. so let's do a second model, which is basically our model too. And we would do like a more complicated thing. Basically what we did right now is like a simple irreversible reaction from one metabolite to the other. Of course, we could often we want to do some things like linear chains or something like that. What we would do now is basically create a linear chain. Tutorial session. Okay, the units we can leave all the same. We would also keep one compartment. The cytosol is okay, but we would basically create our reactions programmatically. So we would just put in basically call this the first species. This is our S1. This is also now not really glucose anymore in our chain. This is just S1, but a chemical. And then we would create basically the rest of the information we would create programmatically, meaning outside of the model, we create, we add like the objects later on. So we basically have a model object which already contains certain things, but it doesn't contain all the reactions in the species. At this point, we basically have like an empty model, a model with a compartment, and the species S1 is in C. And now we want to add additional information here in the basically a linear chain. For the linear chain, we need basically a lot of species. So we want a certain chain length. So in this case, we just do this 10, and then we add all these objects to the model. So for so that I'm not getting a headache with all the indexing, I will call this S0, S0. So we go over the chain. So if our for the zero, we already have this in. So I have to think. We have the S0 already in, so we want 10 elements, so we have to run this in chain -1 times, and then I take question what the chain length is. I would say it's a number of reactions here, then it's also easier, and then we would just add here the species to it. So we're adding the species. Now we can of course do this programmatically. So we have our model and add to the existing species we have. We append the new species, which we create in this loop. And this would be just the next species in our list, which is basically our k plus one. So which is in the compartment C. Also the names are of course not correct, but we do just a k plus one. Annotations we're ignoring for now. Species are the units are all okay. And then we would to the reactions append the respective reactions. And give the correct names. So this would be just our okay. Biochemical reaction, of course, now we have to create the reaction string dynamically. So this is converting our S from K to our SK plus one. It has certain parameters. We could reuse the parameters. So this either we could define like different parameters for everything. In this case, I would just reuse we use the parameters here, and we use the parameters, and of course now it doesn't make much sense to put them here in a local object, but let's just put this reusable parameters on the global object. So we have the parameters here, the RV max and the RKM. And here we would use the glucose. And then in our actual reaction equation, yeah, we have to adapt, of course, the formula. This would be always the R. And now we have the irreversible the substrate is converted as K. Okay, so and here the glucose. So what I did here programmatically by for the just to create objects, of course you can do this also for annotations and basically for all the attributes. The whole idea is that you can be as empty as you want at the beginning, and you can programmatically add all the attributes and everything, and then at certain points you can just check if everything is valid and get all the feedback. And I found this very helpful in this modeling workflow, just to let this run and see basically what is wrong. I think this is often like a bit of a hacking approach, that you get good feedback and good error messages, what is not working, and then seeing what is going on. And here of course we need our model too. So yeah, let's see if this works. Okay, we see like we get a lot of warnings, but we already see a nice star in here. Yeah, and if you look here, okay, yeah, now we created a pretty big model, linear chain, and connected everything, gave the right names, but of course like there's still problems somewhere. But here this also looks like this is nicely connected and so on. Yeah, some things about the graph visualization is very nice, that you can very easily create subgraphs. You can just traverse nearest neighbors and then create new subgraphs analyzing that. And this is also very helpful in model analysis, that you go just and you're interested in certain subsets, or you want to only select something which is connected to the cytosol, for instance, here, and then go in the subgraph and so on. So you can create different views for the same network for debugging, which I found very, very helpful. Also, like here, we see again like a dangling parameter, which is never a good sign. So most likely our error messages are like this looks nicely connected, but there's some problems here. But yeah, it's very easy to figure this out. Of course, now we have a lot more messages because we created a lot more objects. And here the formula in the users HKKM, that is not the ID of a species compartment. So we don't have an H, we don't have anything like that in there. So we have to look to our compartments. And yeah, here we didn't update basically the prefix. We just have the wrong name. But I think it's pretty easy to figure out from this error messages, okay, what was wrong? And then you just fix the error, and then you have a correct model. Yeah, this is basically the model building and model visualization thing. There's of course you can do this with hierarchical models and so on. Yeah, you can also do very simple model composition by just combining two models. So basically, you would just create a second model objects with different things, and then you would just combine model one and model two. So you can reuse components, you can do things like that. And this is, I think, the model composition and the hierarchical model composition, they are very helpful if you reuse things and do things very often. Also, I personally find this programmatic aspect of changing things very, very helpful, because you can do things like, okay, I'm not adding annotations. And then afterwards, I just go over, like for instance, here we for our okay, here we already put the annotations, but I basically could just add these annotations later on programmatically and just saying, okay, if a certain pattern is matched, then add the SBO term or the annotations to the model. Yeah, and then you can simulate the model very easily, like for instance Roadrunner or Copasi or SPML sim. Like we would just try a quick simulation to see if we have a reproducible model. And would use different things, like for I think we can quickly check Copasi and quickly run this here in SPML sim and in Roadrunner, just to show like how nice it is if you have SPML then to use the different tools. So let's start Copasi. For that, okay. So and then we can just easily import the model. Okay, we have to of course figure out where we saved it. This was our Copasi. Copasi. Combine tutorial. My model. We have the results. We can just open that. This is the HTTPS or the HTTP prefix. I don't know. This you should Copasi should. Come on, it's a. I think there's a prefix. Like you should work with the HTTPS prefix. Oh, this is for Frank here. Okay. But yeah. Okay. This is okay. This was just some interchangeability. But okay. So okay, we see also our nodes very nicely in Copasi that we have this on this object. So we basically documented for someone else who's now using our model in Copasi. We basically documented where we had the parameter. I think we also documented. So we also really parameter overview. Chemical regions, global quantities. Yeah, we documented that. So we have basically documented this for another tool, and it's in interchangeable, and other people can work with that. And also our annotations, they are basically they are exchangeable. So good news here. Let's see if we can simulate it and also reproduce a simulation. Sorry for being a bit longer. I think I need another 10 minutes, then I'm finished. And so we would run a simulation with that. This we do with the task time course. I would use the output assistant here. Basic concentrations create and would run a simulation for we have something in minutes, and so the units and all the stuff is also used, which is very nice. The inner entire side automatic run. Okay, so we should use a bit less time, but this is now we know the time scale approximately of the kinetic we put in here. So we would simulate this until 10 and use also a bit more points. Okay, I see this looks pretty okay. Where are some demos? Okay, this looks pretty good. Just goes down linearly, and our KM is very low, and so it's basically linearly until we go to the KM. Okay, looks all good. Let's see if we can reproduce that. Here we see the glucose is the one which is going down from 10, and the other one is going up. This makes also sense. Our concentrations are right. We have the millimole and we have our minutes. And so this is like by documenting all the units, this is very nice and people understand really the time scales and so on, what we're talking about. How would we do the same thing in Roadrunner? Because we need like somehow we need Roadrunner for that. So we would just install that. and then would make a simulation with our model. We created this in the results folder. For now, I would just add our simulation at the end of this model one. So this is just simulate the whole thing, and I will just define here the path of the model which we want to simulate, and then we will load it and simulate it. So we import Roadrunner. And then after, here we do the simulation, the SPML pass. So, and then we just have to do the simulation, which is just loading the model into a Roadrunner object. And then we would simulate it. Normally, we don't have to select any selections. So we'll just simulate this from zero. And we simulate it until 10 in Copasi. So basically, we would reproduce this simulation here. We have the end is 10, and the steps, I think we have 1000 in the end. This is all we have to do here. I would wrap this in a pandadatas frame. The data frame, and then we can basically plot this with matplotlib, or we could also just call here the plot function. I think this should already already do that. And then I need a different object here. So we'll plot that, and then I just print also the content of the data frame. So okay, so this is a simulation, and now we should get hopefully a figure also. We've got a figure, and okay, we don't have any Excel labels here, but this is we could basically reproduce this, and already we use two tools, and with so far so good. It's like already far away. Like if you have any questions, so now, I think now is the time to ask. But also, like, if you have, if you want to see something demonstrated or additional things, just let me know. Yeah. Otherwise, I could make a short demonstration of SPML sim. In addition, this is basically just would also use it's a bit of abstraction layer around this around Roadrunner. My friends before assignment, he was still an error. Which just it's not much different. It just has a better support for the units. And okay, and here we see then the simulation results. It goes from 10 to 0, and this goes from 0 to 10. Yeah, I don't know. If there's no more question, then I would just stop at this point. If you want to see something more, then now is the time to speak up. Okay, perfect. Oh, okay. Okay. No notes on global parameters. Okay, on local ones. To Frank, yeah, also, we also have, we also basically do everything via global parameters. We just write them. The trick is we just write them locally, but they are global parameters are created. I would say this couldn't work like for, I find this, like if you have to create SPML and if you want to model in SPML, I would say this is a very nice tool to do it. And for me, this solved a lot of issues I had with the existing tools. Or basically the problem, okay, I'm writing some normal code and then I want to get into SPML and my model is, basically my equations are already very SPML-like and this provides me a programmatic way to create the model. Yeah. Okay, yeah, so if there are no more questions, thanks a lot for the attendance. Is a citation. Yes, the citations are basically on the tools for now. If you go to the web pages of the tools, basically normally there should always be a DOI. For now, there is not a publication out, but via the DOI, you should be able to reference the respective tools. Like so, like if you use SPML utils, you should basically is that broke right now? Okay, but you basically should use this citation for now. And there's here basically have this latest versions always, and then you can there's a on Zenodo. I think here's a cite button there. You can basically cite all version or cite here, and you can just export this as a BibTeX key and then just use that. Yeah, yeah. For me, also the idea was like showing a bit the workflow that other people know what I'm doing or what is one way to do it. But my key philosophy is like to try to do everything with SPML in the end, and like that the tools can exchange as much as possible using packages or annotations. And I think this is also this allows then people in the community to just use the few things they find useful and can put them together. Yeah, ZML stuff. I'm hiding from that a bit. I'm like the ZML things is much more like how is it, like this is much more hacky at the moment. But a lot of things is going in the same direction that I basically have a bit of abstraction layer around ZML, which makes it more simple for me to create the objects. The challenge is a bit like, okay, of course, like in the simulator and the software allow more things than in ZML, and to keep it somehow compatible, this is not very easy. Like especially like, okay, figuring out certain things I can't put into SPML and back. Yeah, but the plan is definitely showing more of the ZML things close. Hopefully tonight I don't think I can do, but like probably tomorrow I can already show like some things. I'm in the process of cleaning that up. Okay, yeah, thanks a lot. If you have more questions, just contact me. I'm here the rest of the week. Otherwise, there is an, if you're interested in ZML, there are sessions tonight and tomorrow evening, or depending on what time you are, but like there's basically about ZML level 1 version 4, which is more about the simulation experiments. So now that you have your model, how would you simulate and execute the whole thing? Tomorrow more about the future, where should the simulation experiment description language go? And on Friday, we put also a session for the combined archive in. Yeah, but I didn't show today. I also have support for combined archives. So it would be also very easy to now put these two models into an archive. This is just basically importing a bit more things. It would just, it would just be importing the omics and then creating an omics object and putting the two models in there. So this is also straightforward to include omics here directly. And if you created your model to just package it afterwards into an omics file. In the spirit of trying to demonstrate everything here, I think it's. You would just create basically an omics. Let's see what I have to do. Create omics archive. Okay, and then I should basically hopefully just do something Tuomix is add entry. Oh, this sounds good. So I would just add something, and I would add basically the entry, the SVML right now. And what else would I enter? I would enter a manifest entry. Let's figure out what we have to do in there. So we need basically a location. This is where it is actually stored in the model. So in the archive. So this we would store it under model 1XML in the archive. The format is format should have a entry format. In this case, I know it's SVML level 3 version 2, so I can just add this here. And I have a master master I'm not setting, it's just false. And this is basically this should all be added, and then I would just write the omics to an omics pass, which would be my, where's my output path? This was basically just the file parent, and this is my model one omics parent, and this, and this, and then I should already have nice omics archive. Let's see if this works. Ooh. What? No. Manifest entry. And it takes what? Huh. That's already a bug. Manifest entry. What did I do wrong? Location format. Let's see, probably this is a bug, location format. Okay, something worked. Let's see if, we have here an omics file. This looks good. And then we can, for instance, just upload the whole omics with the, and test, for instance, here the upload, okay, show in. This is basically the last thing I would show here. So we can basically have our omics. Oh, okay, this didn't work. Okay, let's see what went wrong. Yeah, but this looks pretty good. We have an SVML in there. We have a manifest in there. So probably something didn't work in the upload. Okay, so, but in principle, yeah, there's omics support. This can be done here. Not much for the metadata yet, but it's also pretty easy to do this directly if you create your SVML files and ZML files to create the omics here. Okay. Yeah, exactly. For Frank, tomorrow more about Copasi and Copasi scripting. I think this is also super interesting. I think, all this, like the Python interfaces or different language interfaces to the actual tools. This is if you have a bit of programmatic background, then this is definitely how you should approach this. Okay, yeah, thanks a lot. Hope to see you in other sessions, and thanks a lot for the attention.